I guess we're ready to go. Hello, everybody. I know how this group loves networking, so I hope people will come back and join us, because we've got a really interesting panel to move on with here. So far this morning, we've been listening to legislative staff, industry leaders, and other critical policymakers in the state talking about issues, and we're going to have that for the rest of the day as well. But right now we have a little something a little different, and we're going to be talking to some professional observers from the media who can tell us about the issues facing California and energy and environmental policy, climate policy, and how those issues look to them. We've got a great panel of reporters, editors, and columnists to chew over the questions that we're going to be grappling with really all day long. We have at the other end of the podium Cassandra Sweet, who covers electric power and renewable energy companies, as well as energy and environmental policy for the Wall Street Journal. Next to her is Jeff St. John, senior editor of Greentech Media, who covers energy technology and regulatory matters for that really important trade publication that I know we all read daily. Next to Jeff is Kate Galbraith, assistant business editor of the San Francisco Chronicle, formerly of Cal Matters, Texas Tribune, and the New York Times. And finally, Dan Morain, editorial page editor, political columnist for the Sacramento Bee. Dan's got a new daily newsletter of opinion and politics called The Take. He told me about it last week. I signed up immediately, and I'm already addicted. So you should check it out. Go to the Bee website, go to newsletters, and put your email address in for The Take. You'll enjoy it. So let's get right into the issues at hand, and we'll start with the hot topic right now, which is the extension of AB 32 with its cap and trade program to reduce carbon emissions. Seems like it's been going along swimmingly for the last few years until lately, when the last auction was a bust. Cap and trade is now on the rocks, and a legislative extension will be needed to provide market certainty going forward beyond 2020. But now Governor Brown says he may take the issue to the voters if he doesn't get an extension out of the legislature. So Dan, what's going on here? We've got a legislative dynamic that seems to have the extension of AB 32 in real trouble. What's going on?
Well, it is. You're right. It's in quite some disarray. It's kind of surprising, really, because I mean, I'm sure you all know this has been a state that has taken a lead on so many of these environmental issues. But it doesn't. None of it has been easy. And this year is going to be the same. You know, there are 2 weeks left in the legislative session, so as you all know, that's a long time in legislative years. So a lot can happen. It's very unclear to me that SB 32 will pass in this year, and if it doesn't pass this year, then it becomes, you know, some very serious brinkmanship next year. The governor's claim that he's thinking about putting it on the ballot, I think I don't think that that's a very good idea. I think that it becomes a referendum on high-speed rail, and I'm not sure he would want that in 2018 as he's leaving office. I'm not sure he would win that. As you know, cap and trade earmarks a quarter of its money for high-speed rail. And while it's popular in some parts of the state, particularly in Fresno where it's being built, I think people in the Bay Area are very skeptical of it, and I know in LA they're very skeptical of it. So it becomes a, you know, difficult situation. I know that there is an effort particularly in the Senate, to push this bill through, but because, you know, really California has, you know, it's in some ways it's a one-party state. it's very democratic, but there are different shades of blue here. And so the moderates, who number about 18 now in the legislature and will number a larger number after November, can team up with Republicans to block anything and or almost anything, and this is one that they're very skeptical of. You know, the moderate Dems are very skeptical that SB 32 and the California Air Resources Board is representing their constituents. So, you know, it's kind of the fight, and it's, you know, it's a three-part fight. It's Democrats, the more mainstream, more liberal Democrats, the moderate Democrats, and the Republicans.
And we saw it in SB 350 as well.
Absolutely, absolutely. And that didn't, you know, the question of cutting petroleum use by 50%, a bold step. Nobody else has, you know, even contemplated that, as near as I can tell. But it didn't even, it couldn't even have even gotten to a vote. And last year, SB 32, it got, you know, installed on the floor. It came nowhere near getting 41 votes it needed in the assembly. It's a question whether it's a 41 vote bill or a supermajority vote bill. A 41 vote bill or a 21 vote bill in the Senate or a supermajority. The governor wants a supermajority because there is money attached to it, and under California law, I'm sure you know, that requires a two-thirds vote. So if he gets a majority vote, which he conceivably could get out of the assembly if he twisted arms, I'm not sure, that doesn't suit him. He wants two-thirds so he will have certainty about cap and trade, and therefore certainty over high-speed rail as it goes ahead.
So that's the politics and the legislative mechanics. Kate, tell us what we should know about the implications for climate policy and further prospects of this industry.
Well, I think there's, as everyone knows, there's certainly a lot riding on this legislative session, both through 2020 and in the long term. I think one of the things California really has yet to show, there's been a lot of praise in the environmental community for California policies, broadly speaking, but these policies are still very new, and the state really has, is still a question in my mind as to whether the state is cutting emissions faster than they're falling nationally. Another question Dan mentioned, SB 350 and the petroleum goal that never made it into law. I mean, our gasoline use is going up this year. Gas prices are cheap. People are excited to drive a little more, go somewhere for the holidays, go somewhere for the summer. And, you know, that is a goal we had. We had a goal of, the governor said he wanted to cut petroleum use in half by 2030. That's 14 years away. And so from my perspective, there are still a lot of questions to be answered about all of these policies, the cap and trade, the LCFS, the goal of cutting petroleum use, and, you know, is this, are these policies driving businesses out of the state? I mean, all of those things really have yet to be seen because there's, these policies are young, so I'll be watching for that.
Cassandra, I wonder if there's even a federal angle in the fate of cap and trade in California. Just a week or so ago, California became the first state in the nation to publish its proposed compliance plan for the Clean Power Plan from the EPA. Centerpiece of that was cap and trade. What does it mean for the Clean Power Plan if California, of all places, doesn't have the wherewithal to fulfill its plan to comply?
Yeah, that's right, Bob. I think certainly a lot of people are concerned about California's cap and trade program and, you know, whether it will survive, you know, this current debate. I think the cap and trade program will survive, and I think the ARB will, you know, has the authority to continue running it to comply with the Clean Power Plan. You know, assuming that the Clean Power Plan survives the legal challenge right now, I've talked to some of the big utilities in the Southeast and other parts of the country, and most of them are planning, making plans to comply with the Clean Power Plan. plan, you know, whether it survives the legal challenge or not. And the reason for that is that they have to plan, you know, a decade ahead, and they can't sit around and wait to see whether the Clean Power Plan you know, survives or not. There are other pollution regulations nationwide that keep utilities from building new coal plants. So the United States is kind of moving in this cleaner energy direction already, even, you know, without the Clean Power Plan. And so I think it makes, you know, and as renewable energy becomes cheaper, you know, and costs drop for, you know, solar modules and wind turbines get bigger and more efficient and cheaper to buy, it becomes more of a market, and utilities are just kind of gravitating toward cleaner forms of energy. And so I don't think that that's going to be a big issue. I think the issue with California's cap and trade program is what role it will play in the state's climate policy going forward, whether it'll play kind of a small role just to comply with federal rules, or whether it'll take kind of a bigger position in terms of, you know, really putting a steep price on carbon to give cleaner technologies, you know, a bigger advantage.
So cap and trade is the purview of the Air Resources Board, but the electric utilities that are very much affected by all the climate and energy policies in California are regulated by the Public Utilities Commission, and the CPUC is coming out of a period of some controversy at the same time that it's expected to be and is driving big changes in the electric power system in California. Right now on the table in the legislature and from the governor is a package of reforms, essentially, of the way the CPUC operates to address some of those questions. Dan, give us the backstory here. How did the CPUC get reform on its plate? It's the governor's plate and the legislature's.
Well, so I'm not sure. So there's a long history to this, right? I mean, the PUC is in excess of a century old. It was created to regulate railroads back in the Progressive era. It evolved, and what basically it has control. It doesn't have control over your phone, unless you have a landline, and not very many people have one of those. It has had jurisdiction over limousines. Kind of crazy. It's giving up that. That is one of the reforms that will happen. This group, I'm sure, knows has had dealings with Michael Peavy. He was the PUC president for 12 years. Got into no small amount of trouble at the end, and basically was forced to leave. He had been under investigation. I have no idea what the status of that is. But the new president, Michael Picker, is a confidant of Jerry Brown's, has been a friend of Jerry Brown's going back to the first Brown administration decades ago. So he certainly has the governor's confidence. He's a very different guy, if you've met him, than Michael Peavy. Peavy is a brilliant man, and you know, would let you know that. And Picker is a brilliant man too, but is a little less assuming. And so it's a very different style. So while, you know, you can make changes in the law, it really depends on who's running the organization. And so, you know, Picker is far more accessible, although because the organization it's a huge bureaucracy and it's very arcane. And if any of you have ever tried to navigate its website, you can just see that this is not an organization that's built for transparency. I mean, it's incredibly complicated. It speaks its own language. Legislators here there are legislators here who just hate it, and part of it has to do with PG&E and its real true failure under PV to regulate PG&E, to ride herd over to PG&E to make sure the pipeline didn't blow up. So, so there will be attempts to fix the PUC. I'm not sure that there's going to be a grand restructuring of it. I think ultimately it's going to remain pretty much as it is with a very different leader.
So hopefully the new leadership and new procedures, the new reforms will help to restore public confidence in this as an institution. But what about the regulations themselves? We've got the electric utility industry that is changing very rapidly with the expanded use of variable renewable resources, with the prodigious growth of distributed energy resources, everything from rooftop solar to battery storage. So this is, we're looking at potentially a very different relationship between electric utilities and their customers than we do today. Jeff St. John, you are our expert on the regulatory structure and process in California. Tell us where you think the CPUC is taking the electric utility industry and what opportunities it's creating for this industry and for customers.
Okay, sounds easy. Well, first of all, they're doing about 12 odd or two dozen odd things simultaneously, all in kind of, you know, lockstep. No, not actually in lockstep. They're doing all these different things, each of which interrelates to the other and influences the other, but are which are proceeding along kind of separate tracks for the most part, you know, in these proceedings. I was actually going to ask my other panelists, if I were to take odds on the chance that our analysts at GTM Research would need to write up some kind of market forecast of the effects of the failure of AB 32 to pass or to continue on renewable energy, what are the odds I should take on that, you know? Because I don't know if that's
calculable. California's not going to go backward.
You mean this year?
Yeah, this
it's
year.
It's not going to go backward.
You know. Or does it even matter is the other question. Or how does it matter? Because I've talked to Michael Peavy, and he said that carbon and carbon reduction and carbon management is going to be a major driver of how the CPUC understands what it has to do with the electricity sector, but he doesn't necessarily know how, and there's no specific mandate that the CPUC has over carbon emissions, right? But it's like part of the broader picture, but I don't know how it interrelates, at least at present. I mean, a 50% RPS, would that get us there? I'm not sure, you know, all by itself. These are, you know, the CPUC is implementing the energy storage mandate that's been passed, and that's a huge amount of, you know, resources. Are they carbon positive or negative? Depends on, of course, when you charge them and when you discharge them and with what power and what you're replacing. But there are a couple other proceedings that are being implemented in some sense independently of the kind of carbon and renewable nexus that could have some influence, I think, on all of this. And one is called the IDER proceeding, or DRP IDER, talking about some acronyms, distribution resource planning, or distribution resources plan, sorry, and integration of distributed energy resources. Two proceedings that have kind of emerged as a way to figure out how to calculate, monetize or value, and then achieve kind of an integrated set of resources, solar panels, energy storage, plug-in cars, that can help the utility reduce the cost of upgrading its distribution grid infrastructure and pay everyone what their distributed energy is worth. And that's interesting because it's a place where, you know, money starts to be taken into account in a fairly short order, because the utilities do these distribution grid plans once every 3 years, and they're billions of dollars. So that's one example. But on the carbon side and how that influences, I know it's supposed to be, it's got to be a long-term, it's a very important long-term issue for the CPUC, but just how they take that and put it into what they do, I'm not sure it's clear.
Well, this governor will never back off. You know, he views this, I mean, I believe him, that he views climate change as an existential threat, and he's not going to back off that. And whoever the next governor is, if it's Gavin Newsom or Tom Steyer or Eric Garcetti or any of these guys, they're all going to continue on this path, right? So we're not going to go backward as a state, at least not for the next you know, 10 years.
And you just wondered now about what this agenda leads to ultimately in terms of regulatory reform. You had the, you know, half a dozen or more open dockets that are tweaking this this part of the system, that part of the system, how the utilities operate. Cassandra, how far does this get us? Does that really get us to the kind of system that gives customers all the choices that they are clamoring for in this changing electric power system?
Well, Bob, I think that, you know, I look nationally and, you know, sometimes internationally, and I mean, I think if there this buildup is of dissatisfaction with the CPUC and kind of how they've been doing things and their abilities to kind of respond to things that consumers want and things that, you know, businesses want, I think this could lead to another try at deregulation of California's retail power markets, which we've seen in other parts of the country, and, you know, other parts of the country such as New York, New England, Texas, and much of the Mid-Atlantic, they have deregulated retail power markets where, you know, ordinary people pick their power provider. They have a range of choices, and the power is delivered across distribution and transmission lines that are owned by, you know, the traditional utilities, and consumers and businesses have more choice over who they pick to provide them with electricity, and that leads to competition. And the idea is that that's better for the market, for consumers. It leads to, you know, lower prices, more efficiency, and those companies that deliver the electricity, I mean, they are subject to the same renewable energy requirements as the traditional utilities. So there's a ballot initiative in Nevada right now that's set for the November election that would break up the monopoly of NV Energy, which is, you know, their version of PG&E and Southern California Edison, because a lot of people really want more choice. They want more renewable energy at a lower price. They want to be able to choose. And I think we are entering this period of new technology and innovation. And as we were talking about a little bit before, you know, more distributed generation, more people can get solar on their properties. They can get a battery to store the electricity. We're seeing this on different scales. It's very small now, but as battery prices fall, we could see a lot more of these kind of virtual power plants at, you know, commercial properties, schools, universities, people's homes. And I think there will be a bigger push to kind of create a more kind of dynamic market that's more transparent, where people can buy and sell electricity and, you know, get the type of services that they want, and really aiming for cleaner energy at a lower price. So I do see deregulation as a possibility, and you know, this could be the thing that drives it, this CPUC reform.
You know, and there's one way you do it via ballot initiative for the masses, or you could do it the way, I forget the name of the casino company, but there's a big casino company that just bought themselves out of, bought themselves out of NV Energy, you know, departing load charge equivalent, whatever it's called out there, and now they're doing their own thing. And I think the CNI space, it doesn't require ballot initiatives. So, yeah, I mean, both are going to be happening.
Commercial and industrial customers here in California already can pick their own provider, but if you're a consumer or a small business, you can't. In Nevada, everybody has to go to the utility. So even if you're a big casino, you still have to. I think that's what's pushing the issue. These big energy users, you know, they're seeing all these deals. You know, they want to buy cheap solar, but they can't because they have to go through the utility. So I think we're going to see more of that here in California as well. And so
I'm wondering too that in most of these more competitive markets, the competitive market is managed by the ISO, the independent system operator, whether it's ERCOT in Texas or ISO New England or PJM in the Middle Atlantic states, and now we're looking at California ISO looking to spread its wings across the western part of the country beyond just the single state of California. We've already seen some steps in that direction, Jeff, with the energy imbalance market. How has that worked out?
Oh, geez, I should have looked up, you know, the stats before you asked me that. You know, I think, to the best of my knowledge, it's done what it's supposed to do, but it's a fairly limited range of benefits compared to the kind of more wholesale market integration that has been under discussion at CalISO and with multiple states. A lot of them largely served by PacifiCorp, another Berkshire Hathaway utility alongside NV Energy.
Which would also be connected, I think, right?
Yeah. Well, NV is becoming part of the EIM as well.
Yeah.
You know, there was a, you know, Governor Brown sent some letters out this week saying that we're not going to get to that this legislative season. I guess he was busy trying to save cap and trade.
But, save high-speed rail.
Yeah, all that stuff. But, you know, and in this, you know, announcement that things are going to be delayed a little bit, there was a bit of, you know, PR, you know, talk, you know, CR Club in particular has targeted PacifiCorp's coal-fired power plant fleet, which are facing some big pollution controls upgrade costs that could, hasten, you know, their you know, being shuttered. Sierra Club's a little bit worried that the same kind of benefits of efficiency they're going to accrue to, you know, allowing renewable energy to grow and be traded across, you know, state boundaries would also give a slight edge to those coal-fired power plants and maybe give them a new lease on life. You know, other people have said that, you know, an open market, you know, whatever it does to coal-fired power plants is what the market says it should do, right? Instead of, you know, keeping them alive artificially, you know, or you know, it's not so much artificial. It's just that you have 38 entities that have bilateral kind of power trading arrangements with each other. There's got to be a smarter way to do that, and making a market of it should expose, you know, that, I suppose.
I have to tell you, I used to work in Austin at the Texas Tribune, and I'll never forget being on a bus with some Texans going to on an energy tour of West Texans, and somebody on the bus said, well, most of you probably don't know, there are three power grids in the continental United States, east, west, and Texas, and the bus just burst into cheers. And here it's been, you know, here it's totally different. You know, there's interest in extending operations to other states, and I've been, you know, kind of questioning: is Wyoming really going to be that keen on joining California? Because California is kind of a bad word in some other parts of the country. So I think there's a lot of kind of untapped.
And vice versa, Wyoming, yes, may be a bad word in California too.
Also, that, yes.
I think they would like it because I might be mistaken. I hope it's Wyoming. I think Wyoming has a tax on wind farms, don't they?
So
they would raise more money.
Of course they'd like California can help, you know, upgrade their grids. All kinds of stuff that California could provide as a state like Utah and Wyoming and the other states. I mean, I think it's going to happen, but it has to be. So then, but there is resistance.
Yeah, why do you think it's slowed down? Why is it kicked over to?
Well, because there's concern that you know, as we go green, we're going to start importing coal. I mean, I think that's a big reason.
Well, that's one reason, but I did.
And it's complicated.
The day that that Governor Brown, you know, announced that they were going to take a deeper look at it, I got a statement from the Imperial Irrigation District, and I think they are against it.
Oh yeah.
And I think maybe because they're worried that, you know, energy buyers will buy cheap wind power from Wyoming or Utah instead of building a solar power plant in Imperial Valley, for example. So I don't know. I mean, this is one thing that held back the 33% renewable portfolio standard for, I believe, 3 years. It took 3 years for that to get passed, which it did in 2011. So I think, you know, these issues need to be worked out, but I agree with Dan. I think ultimately it makes more sense to connect everybody and to transfer the expertise that we have in California to other states so that they can figure out how to better integrate intermittent renewable energy like solar and wind power, you know, that are not generating power all the time, so they can figure out how to integrate more of that onto their grids. So I think it's a good thing if they can work out
All right, let's move off electricity a little, well, maybe just a little, and turn to transportation. It's proved a little harder to move toward lower carbon transportation than lower carbon electricity, both technically and politically. California is trying to do this in several ways, with cap and trade, with a low carbon fuel standard, and electric vehicles. What's working and what isn't? Cassandra, you want to start?
Oh, great. Yeah, I mean, if, you know, the oil refiners, they hate the low carbon fuel standard because they see it as just a way to, you know, for them to sell less fuel, you know, which, I mean, if you look at it as a way to put a price on carbon and make fossil fuels more expensive, you know, that could make sense. But personally, I think the state needs to do more with figuring out how to offer people alternatives to fossil fuel. I think electric vehicles, electric vehicles are like 3% of new vehicle sales.
But I think that's
in California, excuse me, you're right, Dan, which is more than other states, but still it's not where Californians wanted to be, you know, 10 years ago when they looked at 2016. And I think the state has these policies that maybe are outdated and need to be, you know, we need to do things differently. We need to move differently. Transportation is, I believe, 36% of our greenhouse gas emissions. It's the largest source. And so that's a really big problem. You know, maybe the rebate should be given out according to how much you drive. So that, you know, maybe an Uber driver who's in the car all day would get a bigger rebate than somebody who buys a Nissan Leaf and just uses it once a week to go to the grocery store. Because those are real vehicle miles. I mean, that Uber driver is generating emissions, and most of those cars are fueled with gasoline. You know, maybe we should have more electric car sharing. You know, some cities have bike sharing programs, but if we had more electric cars available that were cheap for people to use, I think you could get a lot of people out of their, you know, old clunkers, and they would be moving around urban areas, you know, using cleaner energy. So I think these are things that, you know, there are a lot of smart people in California who have come up with these ideas, and it's time to implement them.
Definitely, electric vehicles is one of the big pushes toward lower carbon transportation. In California, the state has a goal of 1.5 million EVs on the roads by 2025. That means a lot of charging infrastructure. And Jeff, you've reported on this. What's it going to take to make EV charging as ubiquitous as the corner gas station?
Yeah. Well, I think first of all, it's probably mostly not going to be on the corner next to the gas station. There got to be some of those fast chargers for people to top off when they're taking long trips, but the most recent efforts at the CPUC, at least, working with the three, you know, the state's big three investor-owned utilities, is to get chargers into multifamily housing and into workplace parking. There are three pilot programs now, but two of which have been approved, one of which PG&E's is still kind of there's a bit of an issue between the charging companies and PG&E about how best to do that. But, you know, they figure if you're gonna, like, I live in an apartment, I can't have an EV. You know, even if I would pay for my parking space, I have no idea how much they're charging for that stuff. The apartment owner would have a real hard time justifying the cost of going in and installing the infrastructure to charge even maybe a half dozen cars. I mean, half dozen cars all charging at the same time are going to blow your demand charges through the roof, and it might require a major electrical upgrade or something like that. But that's where people need to charge for hours at a time. Workplace charging suffers some of the same problems, although it's definitely the one that we've seen kind of take off with, you know, kind of like nameplate, you know, companies like Google putting it in. And I don't really know too much about, you know, the psychology of range anxiety, but I do know that if you could charge at home and charge at work, you're probably going to be cool buying an EV for your commute. Then maybe you could just rent a car when you want to drive out of state or something like that.
Well, I think the problem is that, you know, the affordable cars, which I think the Nissan Leaf is the most affordable one, it has a small battery. It doesn't have the range of a Model S, which you could, you know, you could drive to Sacramento and back, I think, from San Francisco with a car like that. So I think it's really technology that hasn't caught up.
Well, the cost of technology.
I think someday we will have more affordable cars that have bigger battery, because battery prices will come down and we'll have better technology. But yeah. I think it's
and
difficult.
Then you have the whole fun chicken and egg thing of which do you need first to make the other happen, which is part of what the utilities have been doing for several years. I forget when it was, like 2009 or 10. There was a change in regulation. First, utilities couldn't really have any kind of part in EV charging infrastructure. And then I think it was 2 years ago, they said, yeah, you can, but you can't really. You're not really supposed to own it. It's not supposed to be like a rate-based asset like anything else. And this is one of the issues between PG&E and the other two utilities and the charging companies, who have complaints that they think that PG&E might be being too restrictive in terms of structuring the program so that multiple technologies from multiple companies can all compete on a kind of level playing field. Well, but on the other hand, without utilities, maybe we can't get this stuff, we can't incentivize this stuff to get into those expensive multifamily workplace charging settings to begin with. So there's got to be a balance.
Well, last year when the legislature did pass SB 350 without the petroleum piece, the reason the utilities supported it was because it made clear that utilities have a very significant role in charging. So now you're right, the fight is over sort of how big a role, but they certainly have a role. And so ChargePoint and some of these other you know, companies that want to get into the charging business having a big fight with PG&E, right?
So. Mm-hmm. So more EVs means less gasoline. Less gasoline means less gasoline tax money for road repair. The alternative most talked about, Kate, and I know you've been following this, is taxing based on vehicle miles traveled. That seems like an alternative gets talked a lot, but not implemented very much. Caltrans recently started a pilot program, the road charge program. What's that looking like? Is this the future of highway funding for California?
Well, I think it's a really interesting question. This pilot program with about 5,000 participants just started in California in July. It's modeled on an Oregon program, which is really the only kind of fully functional program in the country. In California, it's play money. In Oregon, it's real money. But there aren't many participants in Oregon yet. It's not a sort of, it's a concept that's really difficult to get across to people. Creates a lot of suspicion around privacy, a little electronic thing in the car, although California's trying out alternative, you know, sort of non-tech alternatives with stickers and inspections and things. But I mean, at the end of the day, it's also not something that is necessarily, it could solve the issue of we can't raise the gas tax, but we need more funding. It could address that, but on the other hand, it actually sort of penalizes, one could say, electric cars while rewarding gas guzzlers compared to the status quo. If you charge per mile rather than per amount of gas, then that's sort of what happens. I mean, the advocates certainly say this just kind of levels the playing field. It makes, you know, people who buy electric cars, including Teslas, pay their fair share. And so I think that that discussion has yet to come to the fore prominently, and it'll be a really interesting one going forward. But I also think that given the difficulty of raising the gas tax, there's also going to be tremendous difficulty in getting people to accept an entirely new program. So it's certainly worth looking into the future, but we'll see.
You're so right, and it's one of the most interesting fights going on right now in the legislature. You know, there's an Assemblyman Fraser, the chair of transportation in the Assembly. He wants a 20 cent per gallon tax. Well, it's never going to happen, right? And so and vehicle miles traveled is complicated, and people are skeptical. And then you've got the notion of raising the car tax, which would make some sense, but it's a car tax, and that's kind of a third rail in California. So it's a real problem. It's kind of fascinating. And our roads are getting worse and worse.
I don't think anyone would ever agree to getting taxed on the number of miles that they drive. I think that would be worse than a car tax.
Yeah. And no, it's a big problem.
That's how Arnold Schwarzenegger was elected during the
one
recall
of the
election,
ways.
Right? On the
yeah.
car tax.
One
that's how
ways,
much people
yeah.
hated.
All right, well, we're getting to the last few minutes, and I want to just get a little bit of the flavor of the politics of the day. And we've got an election coming up both in the state and nationally. Dan, you mentioned that you thought that the numbers of the moderates in the legislature could very well go up in the next legislature. What are the key races that you're looking at, and how could they affect the complexion of the legislature next session?
Well, the number of moderate Democrats will go up by 8, right? I mean, just based on the primary results. I mean, it's a certainty. And then the question is, how many Republicans are going to lose? Because this is not going to be a good year in California, I don't believe, for Republicans. So, you know, in the Assembly, they could lose 4 or 5 seats. I mean, that's a big deal. Now the people who win those seats are not going to be far-left libs, because they're going to lose then in 2 years. And that could well be what happens. It could be this sort of seesaw that goes back and forth every 2 years. So in a presidential year, there's a race down in Torrance. Marasucci, I think his name is a Democrat. He got knocked off 2 years ago by Hadley. This year, Marasucci probably will come back, and then I don't know if 2 years out, Hadley will come back, right? So it'll be the seesaw. But you know, it's not as if the replacement in that Assembly seat is going to be a far left Dem or a far right Republican, right? So it becomes, you know, again, kind of the third party in California, although they call themselves Democrats, they're going to be more moderate. And the Republicans are more moderate, except for they'll never vote for a tax, as near as I can tell. So the number of Dems will go up, almost certainly. But whether that means there would be something dramatic like a car tax or, you know, vehicle miles traveled, a vote for that, to me, it's very unclear.
And then there's that other election that's taking place in November for president. Dan, I know you spent the 2 weeks at the national party conventions, got to see the dynamics up close. What does this audience of advanced energy leaders need to know about the two candidates, or all the candidates for that matter, for president?
Well, you know, I think that the issue really comes down to control of the House, right? I mean, I think, you know, I mean, of course, there are 3 months left, a little less than 3 months left till the election. So of course, something could change dramatically, and Trump could win. But you know, he's losing in battleground states. It could change. I mean, God knows what WikiLeaks has. but But you know, this, you know, that Susan Collins announced the other day that she's not going to vote for Trump. I mean, that's significant. We have other members, other candidates running for the House in California who are saying the same sorts of things or waffling. You know, there's a race here in Sacramento, east of here, between Scott Jones and Ami Barra, and Jones had said he was going to vote for Trump early, and now he's saying he's not so sure. So, you know, it's going to depend on what the polling is in these individual districts. There may well be members of Republicans who won't say. They'll try to get up to November 8th without saying who they're going to vote for. It'll be tough if there's any reporter in that district, but they will try. But it could well be that Trump will win in some of these congressional seats, you know, that he's polling well. I mean, he's polling reasonably well in the Jones-Barra seat. He's polling well, and there's a race going on for Lois Kapp's seat down in the Santa Barbara, San Luis Obispo area, and Trump had been polling well there, although, you know, it could start changing. So I think the fight is really going to come down to the House. And the Republicans probably will hold it, right? I mean, there's a lot to overcome there for the Dems. I don't know, maybe you guys have a different view.
Well, I'm going to wrap things up by posing a question to Kate Galbraith that I'm going to admit right off the bat is completely unfair. You've been a reporter on energy and environment nationally for the New York Times, The Economist, in Texas for the Texas Tribune, California here, and Cal Matters. At the Chronicle, you're a business editor. So here's my question. I'll report advanced energy jobs in California, which a number of people have been picking up at the table out front. That shows the advanced energy industry supports more than 500,000 jobs in California, more than agriculture, three times the iconic motion picture, TV, and radio industry. Employers added jobs at a 15% rate last year. They're adding jobs at 8% this year. Do you think the advanced energy industry gets the attention it deserves as a growth engine for California, from policymakers and from the media?
Well, if you ask me an unfair question, will you like my answer? Two things quickly. One, when I worked in 2008-09 at the New York Times, and I actually felt like we were constantly being deluged with reports on, you know, wind, solar jobs in XYZ state, to the point where, you know, I had to remind myself these are not the only industries in the energy sector that exist. And you know, indeed, when I get, I'll look at the report with interest. But I always want to know, how are you defining the jobs, and you know, kind of comparing across sectors, different reports is always an interesting challenge. So I look forward to seeing it.
Well, unfair question deserves an unfair answer, so that certainly works out. So I want to thank our panelists for a great discussion, Cassandra Sweet from the Wall Street Journal, Jeff St. John, Greentech Media, Kate Galbraith from The Chronicle, and of course, Dan Morain from The Bee. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.